And we're finally live. Welcome to whoever might be listening. Welcome to yet another random, unscripted, unthought of. No, really, we did not think this one out properly. Episode review of The Average. Okay, I'm done.
That's kind of.
Yeah. So, good night and good luck.
So today we found something else. We found a fun little PDF with another game.
Well, it's still D&D based.
It's called Killer Kobolds from Outer Space.
Which apparently, by the way, I looked at it. It's itself is an expansion and a setting for a little D&D minigame called Killer Kobolds.
Okay.
Yeah, apparently this guy really likes kobolds, like our very own Victor. Who will probably be DMing this in about 2 weeks.
We can harvest humanity with brutal B-movie style.
In Killer Kobolds from Outer Space. Not approved by Wizards of the Coast. So it's made by a guy, mostly by a guy made Oliver
Clegg.
And it's a one-shot adventure in space with kobolds.
Space.
Yeah. The PDF's pretty short and...
They're short. It has 22 pages.
My ass, it's like a demo book.
Your ass is short.
I don't think this contains enough pages for me to wipe myself
but
with.
But is it saggy?
I have no idea.
It can be.
If you play the saggy subtype of kobold. What? Anyway, so we thought we'd take a look at this. Not with too much metagaming in mind, but to see what it has to offer. As a preview for when we'll be playing it. So, while you look at warehouses on a local farming site and local news about guys getting run over with several types of cars. Fascinating. There's a video from our town for someone getting run over with a car. Either way, welcome demonetization. It's us. Yep.
Well, you said it.
I just described it.
It's officially your fault.
It's my fault this time.
Yes.
So, to start off, no one knows where the killer kobolds originally hail from. They appear at random places throughout the multiverse.
From Feyran.
Harvesting my ass. Innocence. And destroying towns before vanishing back into the mists. Their attacks are random, but devastating. Often leaving towns completely deserted. Killer kobolds are like ordinary kobolds, but 2,000 years more technologically advanced. Alas, all this advancement has done nothing to improve their temperament, aim, or table manners. Killer kobolds with a Z, by the way.
Z?
Here it's with a Z.
Oh, okay.
Come in several varieties, all of which...
Display a decidedly homicidal streak.
Disclaimer goes here. Okay.
Only the kobolds are homicidal?
Yep. So, the kobold
fuck me. The kobold sheep called the Yip
is fueled by biomass, specifically the remains of melted humanoids. Rather than cull the necessary tributes from their own ranks, the kobolds refuel from the corpses of their victims, which
they melt into
the puddles and collect. By the way, it's literally a UFO.
Well, it's a B-rank movie, so it looks awesome. Oh, God.
Okay, good, good.
It's almost done with the...
Killer kobolds from outer space. Splace, yes, splace. Pays into B-movie horror tropes. Founded by glorious tragedies such as Attack of the 50-Foot Woman, Eight-Legged Freaks, or, yes... Killer clowns from outer space! Had to.
Yeah.
It plays on dark comedy vibes and involves a great deal of senseless violence. Just the kobolds, it's fine, we're okay.
It's perfect for our stream.
Yep. Unthought of.
Yep.
For this reason, by I, we mean not us, but the creator of this here PDF.
Oh, come on.
I had to. Strongly advise you to check with your players before introducing them to my brain short-circuiting, to this motto. If, like me, the creator, Your sense of humor tends strongly towards the macabre. You'll probably be fine, but remember to use your safety tools. And keep in mind that violence on this scale, even when touched in the cartoon comedy of clueless extraterrestrial kobolds, can be difficult for some.
Yeah, you can already describe brains in so many ways, then it's difficult to describe it.
No, I mean, it's fair, because this PDF came out, you know, like 2 or 3 years ago, in which political correctness and trends like that were already quite vibrant in Western society and where D&D has most audience. So, you know what, that's a good disclaimer we should...
But now that's out of the way?
Yeah, you're right. So, on with the slaughter! Players take on the role of highly over-equipped and grievously untrained kobold soldiers on their errands for the kobold queen with a K.
Queen.
Only who demands the way?
Queen. Who demands various tasks of her servants before the ship can take off back into the mists of Ravenloft.
Ravenloft?
Ravenloft.
Wait. Yep. This is originates from Ravenloft?
Yep.
Alright. How to play. A game of killer kobolds is a rampage throughout the streets, equipped with bizarre weaponry and mad science. There's no moral. There's no clever twist. Just kobolds causing absolute havoc and probably getting killed for their trouble. The game can take place over one or more scenarios as a clueless village becomes the target. Sorry. Becomes the target of an aggressive killer kobold incursion. So, step one, select the scenario. First, we choose a scenario from the list below. You may instead choose to determine the scenario randomly by rolling a d4.
So you have fuel for the engine god, scavenger hunt,
Shanghai,
or kobold kill count.
Right. Well, let's find out.
Or optional finale against the queen.
We got the kobold kill count. Wait, is this a death wave?
Yeah.
God. Step two, choose a champion. Fuck me.
Before starting the scenario, players...
Oh no, wait, who's a champion? Yeah.
From the rooster in this module, show your players the available kobolds and allow them to choose one.
All kobolds use the base template provided later based on their color. If a kobold is ever detonated through through this place. So you can play each color of kobold once through a scenario.
Yep.
With no take back season, basically.
Step three.
No. Let's you know what? We chose the scenario, let's choose our kobolds. Cause these are the scenarios and I don't think we should delve on these too much. So
well, the scenarios are cool. Yeah. Let's see what the scenario says, at least.
Well, the scenario we chose is the fourth one, which is Kobold Kill Count. The Kobold Queen froths at the mouth. The humans must die, she cries out. All of them. Whoever performs this task for me will be well rewarded. The kobolds are ordered to cause utter carnage in the name of the Kobold Queen by any means necessary. The kobold that slays the most meatbacks will be allowed to return on the yip yip yip. The rest will know her wrath. This scenario's special rules is, at least one kobold must be a red kobold. The queen knows who to send on her ugliest tasks. Each kobold can take one kaboom contraption for free. We'll get into those. The kobold that kill most humans. Wow. The kobold that kill
the most humans in a 1 hour period is allowed to return to the ship. The rest are detonated.
Alright, so that's your scenario. Of course, the optional scenarios later on, but we have the red killer kobold, which knows pack tactics.
The gooey kablooey.
No, they all have that, but with different things. So, if a red killer kobold is reduced to 0 hit points, it explodes in a gooey mess, scattering kobold entrails over every creature within 5 feet of it. Any creature within 5 feet of a kobold, when it explodes, must make a dexterity saving throw, DC 9, or take 2, 1d4, fire damage, half on a save. So,
your hit points are 1d6 minus 2?
Yep.
2d6
minus 2.
And you receive 12.
My god, that's so bad. Anyway, so, kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. You get 3 of them.
Yep.
Hazard, Boomer, and Crash. It's like Pokemon Evolutions.
Yep.
Right. Then there's the blue killer kobold, which has pack tactics. Yeah, oh, okay. So they all have pack tactics.
Each one of them has a few flavor text.
Yeah, we'll get to those. The blue guys who...
He has stand back and mass science.
The kobold attempts to manifest the contraption of their choice. There's a 50% chance they obtain it. There's a 30% chance they get a contraption of the DM's choice. There's a 20% chance the kobold explodes as per a fireball spell centered on another location.
Perfect.
I love it. Then we have brains. Minoy.
Genius.
Wait, genius.
Minoy.
It's like I know?
Yeah.
Is it a wordplay on I know?
Yeah, like Brenes.
Yeah, brains.
Brains and genius.
Genius. I love genius. Anyway, then we've got the green killer kobolds, and I think they're the final ones of the bunch, right? No, they're not. They're second to last. They're invisible. That's it.
Use the power. They may choose to use this power to defecate on anything that isn't nailed down, or it may not.
It what?
To defecate.
Oh, it may choose to. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And we've got Snippy, Snort, and Snide. I think these are my favorites so far.
They are ghosties.
Yep. Then finally, we've got the brown killer kobolds. Who has regeneration? It regains one hit point at the start of its turn.
Nice.
Unless it takes fire or acid damage. Then it's disabled for a turn.
You got slurps,
spats, and squids. Oh, and then you've got gray killer kobolds. So there's more types. They've got bulks. Oh, these are buff guys. Wait, are these actually dragon points?
Yeah.
Right. They've got bulk smash. They've got siege.
Then the kobold deals double damage to objects and structures.
All right. And we've got Parp, Bog, and Whelp. All right. So we selected our kobolds in our scenario. Let's find out what we do next. Step 3. Close contraptions.
And for this scenario,
choose contraptions. Yeah.
Each has one scenario.
One free one. So we get to choose two contraptions, I think. Once each player has chosen a kobold, show them the contraptions later in this document. Each kobold chooses three. So for this scenario, we actually have four each. All right. A contraption can be used once in a scenario before it breaks or runs out of power. Oh, God.
The group can only take a single instance of any device.
No multiples. Oh, Jesus. Each kobold is marked with either kaboom, boing, oops, zap, or omg. If a device has the same marking as your kobold, roll a d6 when you use it. On a 4 to 6, you retain the device and can keep using it.
You're attuned to the device. And step 4.
It's a natural attunement. Step 4, you play. Yep. Alright, so let's see some contraptions. This PDF is all over the place, my guy.
It's pretty linear, come on.
Yeah, it is, but it looks.
Well, you keep zapping through it for some reason.
Oh no! I don't mean that. I mean I didn't want to look over the scenarios too much since we'll be playing it.
You know.
All right, but everything else is fair game. So, first one, we've got a saw. It's a melee weapon attack, +4 to hit, reach of 5 feet, so we're right next to you. On target, you either hit 9 damage. Or 2d10 minus 2 piercing damage. It's called a lobotomatronic saw. It's a pizza cutter.
But with a blade.
No, that's a...
No, that's not a pizza cutter.
It's a serrated pizza cutter,
my guy. It's a serrated pizza cutter.
Yeah, it's still a pizza cutter.
Well, you get then the electro spatula. Which is a lightning bolt of DC9.
Wait, is this the spell lightning bolt?
Yeah. You can cast it through the spatula.
It's like 86.
Yeah, but it's DC9.
Then you get 7 sticks of dynamite.
DMG, page 267.
It's called the Diplomat's Kit.
You get the 7 League Boot, which is dimension door in a random direction.
And it's a spring.
Yep.
Then you get the reverse gravity with a grav blower of DC9, which is a leaf blower. For fuck's sake.
You got the fusion rod, which is a rod of +4 melee weapon. It hits for 1d6 minus 1 damage, and you become stuck to the target as if bounded by sovereign glue.
That's incredibly fucking powerful, by the way. Wow. Then you get the supersonic screwdriver, which nets you a flying speed of 120 feet, but when using it, you must move their full flight speed in one direction on your turn. If you would move into a creature or object, you then crash, taking falling damage for that distance instead.
Based on the distance move, not the distance fall.
No, not the one remaining, the one that you've already consumed. God damn it. Then
you got the turbo launch pad.
Is this an Acme PDF?
Oh, come on, it took you that long?
Motherfucker.
When you use a turbo launch pad, you launch 1 mile into the air. You might be thinking, this has no practical use, I can't fly. And you would be right.
I love this one. Right, then you get Flebuntinium. When opened, Flebuntinium randomly casts one of the following spells of DC 9. Pass wall, knock, time stop, tiny servant, unseen servant, and find familiar.
Oh god.
It's
yes.
A roll of a D6, so you know what? Let's just try
sure,
this.
Sure, sure. You get pass wall.
That's reasonable. How about you?
I get knock.
Okay, we're good.
It's fine. You get the discombobulator.
Oh god.
Which is a hammer.
Gonna love this one.
Yeah, it's a +4 to hit, reach of 5, 1 target hit, 1d6 minus 2 damage,
or 2 damage,
bludgeoning, and the target is pushed up to 30 feet away from you. If the target meets a wall, they crash through it and fall prone.
Get the charging thing. And then you get the charging cable. Use the charging cable on a corpse to recover all used contraptions for 1 kobold.
Yeah, damn. You plug your contraption into a corpse and you fuel them with it.
Damn, that's really good.
You get the connector, as you can activate as many contraptions as you want in a single action.
I think I know my kobold.
Okay.
These two.
And more contraptions.
There's a lot of them. You get the relativity rocket, which is a firework. Killer kobolds have theorized for years about how and why the relativity rocket works, but at the end of the day, it just creates a crater fine wherever you understand it or not. It's a fireball.
DC9. You get the thermodynamic tincture. Drink this tincture, grants you immunity to fire damage and also a bad case of indigestion.
You shit yourself?
Yep. Fire.
Nice. Then, one of sci-fi's most favorite, the green glowing thing in a jar. You can use an action to open the jar. That's literally a green glowing thing in a jar.
Yep.
You can use the action to open the jar. The jar unleashes one of the following effects at random. Sickening radiance, daylight, sunbeam, or light. All effects are green in color.
Nice.
Sunbeam. I unleashed a sunbeam of green. Nice.
Then you got the hydrophonic helmet. When wearing this helmet, you can use an action to cause one of the following effects at random. Entangle, plant growth, awaken, only on plants. Speak with plants, tree stride, or guardian of nature.
My guy. Okay. Alright, then you get a screw. This probably belongs somewhere important, so bringing it with you can only be lucky. You gain inspiration at the start of the scenario.
Nice. And you got the astrobaroviometer. Killer kobolds rarely keep track of the weather, but when they do, the results are always spectacular. Storm of Vengeance of DC9.
Then you get one. It's not even the last one. You get the grand plan and stuff. This is a jumble of paper outlining the endgame of the Kobold space program, in which they outline their ambitious plan to kidnap a star. It should be easy. Papers include stars are so small. A Kobold which survives the mission carrying the grand plan can choose their next scenario rather than the DM.
Nice.
That's funny, though.
Yep. Then you get the one with knobs on. This small metal box has two levers on it. One is red and one is blue. When you pull the red lever, something's red nearby explodes. When you pull the blue lever, A, something blue nearby explodes.
For fuck's sake. You know what I do?
You know,
I play green kobold.
Yeah.
And just stay real close to my blue and red kobolds and go.
Yep.
All right. Then for the next contraption, we're already on page 5 or 6 of contraptions. Jesus fucking Christ. We've got the biomorphic tutor. It's a bicorn.
Yeah.
The biomorphic tutor casts polymorph of DC9 in a 30-foot cone in front of you. It also makes a funny toot sound.
Then you get a sharp thing. It's a dagger. Plus 4 to hit. It deals 1d4 plus 2 piercing damage.
Then you get the grab-o-matic. It's a melee weapon attack of plus 4 to hit, reach 20 feet.
Oh god.
On hit, the target is grappled of DC 9 and is pulled 15 feet towards you. Oh god.
You get a pressure cooker. It's a delayed blast fireball of DC 9.
Then you get the hyperbaric calculator. It's a revivify spell.
Nice. Then you get a not a bomb. It's a bomb, but not a bomb. Killer cobbled not a bomb are, alas, misnomer. A fact that is lost on most of the kobolds that uses them with an amusing result.
So kobold would not know this, not a bomb, is actually a bomb.
Yes.
Nice.
It's a firestorm motif of DC9.
Then you get a Cubix Rube. It's a wall of force.
You get the kobold juice. Is it a juice for kobold? Is it a juice made of kobolds? We may never know, but it makes for a good universal solvent.
Then you get the faraway cage. Well, sure, it's the iron bands of Bilaro. But, hold on. So the naming on these is the round one is the funny name, right? So the faraway cage is their name for the iron bands of Bilaro, but the iron bands of Bilaro are not a single use item.
Well, now it's a single use item.
Yeah, fair enough.
Then you get the Heward's Handy Hover. This odd but ingenious invention can siphon 1 gallon of liquid in under 6 seconds, depositing it into a small but deceptively capacious tank attached to the user's waist.
Huh. Then you get one of... Look. This is where we go off into a bit of a tangent. You know, Eastern Europe is mostly called hard territory, where people punish people for transgressions against law, nature, their elders, especially in scholarship, yes? We, men and women of Eastern Europe, know that when child misbehaves, you beat the shit out of it. Not even kidding. Look,
well,
child
now,
misbehaves...
Now we have laws against it.
Yeah, but, you know, we're so far behind as a country. Listen, when child misbehave, beat the shit out of it. Now, we're so progressive, right, that we even thought to authorize other people to do it for us. Teachers. So, back in the day, you have a ruler, big ruler, made of, like, oak or some shit.
May...
Swack!
Make No. Make child stand like this.
Oh, yes.
And then, twack.
So, make child make like Italian and then flatten those little fingers. You fuckhead. Now, that the parenthesis is over, you get the Rod of Rulership.
Which is a ruler.
Which is a ruler. It doesn't tell you what it measures. The bite marks are an interesting cosmetic choice. Wait, what does it do?
It measures.
Motherfucker.
Then you get the Nutrimatic Liquidator. It's a ranged spell attack. With, minus or equal?
Equal 4!
It's for equal 4 to hit.
Wait, so...
It's a plus 4 to hit.
No, this is a 4.
Yeah. It's a plus 4 to hit.
Yeah, probably.
It deals 1d10 radiant damage, and a creature's reduced to 0 hit points by this damage is turned into a roughly 1 gallon of biofuel, which remains as a puddle for 1 minute before dispensing unless collected.
So, for example, you use the Nutrimatic Liquidator on something, and then you use Heward's Handy Hoover to...
Yep. Huh. And you have fuel.
Nice.
Then you have the...
Credit. And that's about it. Right.
So, the PDF was made by
Oliver
Clegg and Kevin Miller. As
Kevin
the
Miller
illustrator.
Is the artist, yeah. And to be fair, the art on this thing is pretty cool. It's pretty well made, and
it's everything
fun.
you would expect for an old comic.
Yeah, it's kind of a 2000s late 2008 vibe of indie comics, but it's really well made. It reminds me of some of the funnier artworks from Saga, if you've ever read that. It's the one with the two alien races which are at war, and then two of them have sex. I told you about it.
No fucking clue.
Never mind. So,
how about
overall,
we take a closer look?
Yeah, sure. So, now that we've looked over everything but the scenarios, I'm still, you know, halfsy about.
Well, you know them.
Yeah, you're right. All right, so the first one. Meanwhile, in a quiet village. Oh, you get to raise the whole village.
Yep. So. And with a small rule.
So the number of human commoners in a house is 1d4 plus 1. We defend their lives and homes with clubs, but attempt to flee into the night where possible. All humans let off a Wilhelm scream when they perish.
Motherfucker.
So the first scenario is the fuel for the engine god, which is a wordplay for Warhammer.
Yeah, probably.
In the depths of the EPPIP, the Cobalt Queen stretches her hand and points to the fuel tanks.
They are running low. Go forth,
she implies with a wave of her scaly hands.
Come back with fuel for the engine god or don't come back at all.
Shit, it's pretty good though.
Yeah. In fuel for the engine god, the kobolds are set to loose on a village to collect biofuel for the ship using the patented Nutrimatic Liquidator. They must collect 10 gallons of biofuel, which means liquidizing 10 humanoids.
Wait a minute, but it's a single-use gadget.
Yep.
I see a problem here.
Yep. The special rules for the scenario. At least one kobold must have access to a Nutrimatic Liquidator. At least one kobold must have access to the Heward Handy Hoover.
Alright.
When the kobolds have collected at least 10 gallons of biofuel, they are beamed back to the EPPIP. A random kobold is detonated at the cruel whimsy of the queen.
It's a 1 in 4 chance, no, 1 in 5 chance to be the guy who just
bites it.
Who has all the fuel.
Yeah.
Then you've got the scavenger hunt. The kobold queen opens her gigantic maw and exhales dreams of
shiny things. She wants you to find her pleasing artifacts of this world, and quickly before she gets hungry. You wouldn't like her when she's hungry.
Also, in the second panel, bleep bloop, I am a sad robot. The following special rules are hidden. Special objects are hidden in the village. A wonky saucepan. A shiny brooch. 10 colorful buttons. A pet cat called Mittens. A full set of cat-themed crockery.
Oh.
And there is a 50% chance that Kobold searching a house uncover one of these shinies for the queen.
Nice.
Scenario special rules. One kobold must be a blue killer kobold in order to check the authenticity of the shinies. If the blue kobold perishes, the remainder kobolds lose the ability to tell which objects are authentic shinies. When the kobolds have collected all 5 shinies, they are beamed back to the yip-yip-yip. A kobold not holding a shiny when it enters the yip-yip-yip is detonated.
Then you have the
second to last one?
Yeah, Shanghai'd. Shanghai'd.
Yeah, like Shanghai.
Yeah. The kobold's Quen screeches and her meaning is clear. She wishes you to obtain more subjects to bear witness to her glory.
All right. Hold on. Yeah. So she just does.
Yeah, and you know.
Oh, okay.
Bring them to her and bring them to her alive. Sure, my queen. The kobolds are ordered to fetch 5 prisoners from the human settlement. The kobold Quen wants them alive and able to supplicate themselves with appropriate fervor. The kobolds may dispose of the rest if they wish. The special rules for the scenario. At least one kobold must be in the possession of a faraway cage. If the kobolds kill so many villagers that they can no longer meet the quota, they immediately fail the scenario and they are detonated. When kobolds have collected 5 prisoners in the faraway cage, they are beamed back to the EPPIP. The Kvan is angry if her new amusements have been harmed and detonates the kobolds responsible.
Wow.
Right, and then after the kobold kill count
scenario, you've got the special
final scenario against the queen.
Enough is enough! The insanity of the queen must be stopped! If you have the element of surprise, you may be able to stop her before she destroys you!
Well, guess this is where we die, says the one brave, smart kobold.
The kobold queen has the statistics of a young red dragon and lives in an extra-dimensional chamber in the bowels of the ship.
She's not expecting the attack, and it's quite insane beyond recovery.
Evil screeching
and so on.
Scenario special rules. The kobolds may raid the armory and choose an additional contraption before the scenario. The kobold queen barely deigns to fight. On initiative combat 1, each round she detonates a kobold she can see or hear.
So you have 4 rounds to kill her.
Yeah. Well, depends on how many players, because you can have double the color.
Oh, okay.
Only one scenario disallows you to have double the color.
Okay.
If the kobold queen is defeated, the kobolds are free from the tyranny. A red dragon egg is found in the carcass. Perhaps they will raise it. What could go wrong?
Nothing. It's perfect.
Well, this PDF was a bag.
I'm curious what they say about each kobold.
Alright, so, sure, why not? Red killer kobolds are wild and dangerous, preferring to turn people to soup first and ask questions later. They have a worrying affinity for explosives, which is capped by their gory, high-velocity death sequences. Fuck yeah. This is heavy metal right here.
Yep.
Red killer kobolds can rarely be convinced to take missions, any contraptions that do not explode. Because they have a... Where is it? They have kaboom.
Yep.
Their racial is kaboom. Detonate or otherwise fulminate in some spectacular fashion. Perhaps the greatest tragedy of a red killer kobold's existence is that they will never witness their own explosive death discharge, something other kobolds appreciate rarely from a distance while it's not inviting them to parties.
So they used to go boom. Since the racial is going boom.
Then these ones got, kaboom, oops, or zap.
The blue kobolds, or blue bolds, are the tinkerers and mechanics of an invasion force. They can often be found stealing technology from houses, bullying brobolds, or poking humans with spoon to see how they react. If threatened, they scream, throw highly explosive electrical devices, or explode, depending on the subtle variations in the weather. They bowel.
Health,
and a host of other highly unpredictable variables. Wow. If under pressure, blue bolts sometimes attempt to
MacGyver.
They attempt to MacGyver contraptions on the fly with mixed results. Mixed in this context refers to the state of their bodily organs when the dust clears.
Because
they go boom.
Then the green color kobolds or green bolds, I'm sensing a pattern here.
Yep.
Are the stealthy elites of a killer kobold invasion force. If one ignores the clumsy sounds, the constant heavy breathing, and the ever present sense of failure, they might even be good at it. In tense situations, they often use their innate invisibility to hide in buckets, toilets, drains, or other rather
unattractive.
Yep.
Locations. Green color kobolds favor contraptions that make use of their superior stealth abilities, but often find themselves inadvertently in more blast zone or friendly devices. More green kobolds die to friendly fire than any other cause.
Well, since you launch AoEs and don't see anything.
Yep.
Then you got the brown killer kobolds.
Oh, there you go.
The brobolds.
Aww.
Are the biomass collectors and curators of any killer kobold invasion force.
Wait, they're janitors?
They work inside the killer kobold vessel to refuel the ship with biomass harvested from living organisms and also manage the incubation of more killer kobolds in vats on board the ship. This ability extends to cloning kobolds, which is how the colony survives their various expeditions. Unique to brown killer kobolds is the ability to regenerate their own flesh,
whilst it would be very difficult to act in greater disregard for their well-being than their peers to any meaningful degree, brobolds are the most likely to emerge from the scenario in one piece.
Yeah, fair enough.
And they have animoise.
Yeah, they all do. Jesus, oh god, it's uncanny, it's weird. Then you've got gray killer kobolds that are sturdier and stronger than their more colorful counterparts. They often find themselves in positions of authority despite their utter lack of interest and talent for the role, because they're slower than other kobolds and take longer to get to the action. Gray kobolds are distinctive due to their innate understanding of how to break things. A mark of a great kobold leader. In the rare circumstances they should look up from counting their toes to venture an opinion, it invariably revolves around smashing things. All gray kobolds are identical due to a quirk of the cloning process. Really?
Yep.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
Okay. Well,
I have the contraptions.
Yeah, then you got the contraptions and then it's over. It's a fun little thing.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm curious about the original one, to be honest.
Well, we can take a quick look.
Maybe after the break?
Yeah.
Right. And also after the break, because I wanted to discuss some things. Let's, by the way, let's check on the chat, because we haven't so far.
They say hi?
Oh, we have the chat here.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. Yeah. Well, the others are quite nice. Hello. Glad to have you with us again. In mind, body, and spirit, and whatever.
Inside.
Alright. So, I suppose we can take a smart short break. A short break. I wanted to say
a short break.
A magical shard break.
Okay. We're gonna search for the other PDF.
Yeah. And be right back to look at it as well. I think, actually, check this out. Boom! Wow, this guy's prolific.
Oh, God. Ravenloft.
Yeah, he's got something about Ravenloft. The publisher.
But I see no killer kobolds.
How about this?
Yeah, all with caps. Okay.
No. Done. Yep, we found it. But I think we're going to be looking over it after the break.
Let it load.
Let it load. Oh, God.
Oh, God.
Also, the first... Wait.
It's an action packed.
Wait, this one's actually... Holy shit.
Murder Hobo's Advice.
No. Wow.
Oh, it's
this...
an adventure.
This one's an actual adventure and shit?
Okay.
Huh.
It's actually... It takes itself serious.
Huh.
With maps, with everything.
Traps, descriptions, detailed events.
A satanic rune.
He means a Smithsonian rune.
It's a Satin rune.
Satin
rune. Oh, another one.
Oh, God. What is this crap? It also has NPCs and enemies.
Okay, so
they are all kobolds.
So it's a one.
Well, the kobolds are the enemy for this one.
Okay.
I think.
So it's a small adventure.
It's a large adventure, buddy.
Well... A few sessions adventure.
Oh, God, they look horrible.
Well, they look like kobolds.
Yeah, you're right.
Oh, and the boss is a very young green dragon.
It's
the own thing.
Yep. Okay, so I'm guessing we're going to look over this a bit during the break so we know what's up. And then, yeah, it's a fart break. There you go. He under DMC'd us. Nice. Right, so... Right. Welcome back, friends. To this episode of Questionable Relationships. Right. So, we found another one, which is a far bit funnier than the original Killer Kobolds. Apparently, the original Killer Kobolds is an adventure where you play against the kobolds. Has, like, a story arc.
It's a serious adventure.
It's really fucking boring.
We're okay. Not about serious adventures here.
Yeah, no, definitely not. So, we found one that is far funnier. It's in the same vein as Killer Kobolds from Outer Space.
By the same creator.
Yep. Exactly the same people, both.
Yep.
And it's called Master Shark. Be a fish, cook food, die frying. So, you're supposed
Kill your foes and cook under pressure in this aquatic kitchen nightmare for 2 to 4 players.
So, you're supposed to, using D&D rules and preset characters, cook food. It's an actual cook show. So, greetings, delectable morsels. Welcome to another episode of Master Shark, your favorite prime time cookery competition with lethal stakes. I'm your host, Master Shark.
It has piercing in its fins.
And
the scar on the lips.
In the middle of the lip.
Yep.
God damn it. Anyway. So, this week our celebrity chefs will compete against each other for the honor of not being eaten by me. And a small cash prize. So, it depicts a really, really mediocre-looking cooking station area. Each chef will be allocated a station in the Master Shark kitchen and given time to prepare a meal. There's only one real rule to Master Shark: eat or be eaten. Murder, maim, and microwave your way to victory at the expense of the other chefs. On your marks, get set, shark. Okay. So, this one has a couple of rules too. Let's see. Game of Master Shark is a cookery romp in the kitchen. Food is thrown, knives are drawn, fish people are cooked into pies. The game can take place over one or more scenarios as the eponymous Master Shark puts the amateur chefs through the ringer, eventually driving them to theft, murder, and more than likely, a premature death. So, step one, like the other guy, you're supposed to select the chefs. Before starting a scenario, players should each choose a type of chef from the available templates in the rear and have everyone name their chef whatever they like, but suggestions are provided. You can also allow them to use their own characters up to level 5 if you wish. Oh, so this one's got a bit of flavor to it.
So you can make it canon.
God damn it, no.
Step 2, you select the recipes. Each chef knows 2 recipes. Allow them to choose from the options listed in the back of this document. It will be easier if you send the players a copy.
Sure.
You have your recipes. Every recipe has 2 traits to be aware of. A DC for cooking it successfully. Each recipe also has a star rating from 1 to 3. This indicates A, how many ingredients it takes to make, and B, how many points is it worth if cooked successfully.
All right. Then cooking is a thing of its own here. Cooking a recipe is simple. It's intelligence or dexterity or strength. Attempt to roll. A character must possess a number of ingredients equal to the star level of the recipe. Characters proficient in cookery utensils may add their proficiency bonus to the roll. Success indicates the meal is made. On a failure, the ingredients are wasted. And a finite number of ingredients are provided on a table at the start of every encounter. See the kitchen map. Okay, so there's a map of the kitchen.
Then you select the scenario, the sea crowd meets back on the menu boys, the great barracuda bake-off,
or Hell's Kitchen. Alright, and then step four, you play. So, there is a map indeed. Oh my god, it's so stupid. So, there's a cupboard, there's the fridge, there's the bin, and there's tables and cooking area.
Yeah, you have 4 cooking tables.
Then, red tiles are starting tiles where the scenario begins, so each one has a station indeed.
Yep.
Green tiles are ingredient tiles where you can... Oh my god, you can even search in the garbage bin.
Yep.
Alright, so there's indeed cupboard, fridge, and bin are ingredient tiles. Then, you get your basic scenarios. The C word. Welcome back, we're just about to get rolling with our next challenge. The C word. Cookery. Contestants have a random amount of time to prepare as many meals as they can. In the C word, roll initiative as soon as the encounter starts. Chef must make as many meals as they can before the scenario ends, but they have no idea where that will be. At the end of every round, roll a d6. On a 6, Master Shark appears to judge the food and the scenario ends.
Okay.
The winner of the round is the chef who has the most stars amongst their prepared meals. Only meals that are present at the end will be counted. Meals that are eaten or destroyed before the end are not counted. Meals are attributed to whatever counter they are on at the end. So yes, you can steal another chef's meal and take credit. Nice. All right.
Then you have the other scenario.
Yep, meat's back on the menu board.
Sometimes you get bored with the same old food from the same old places. Or maybe you're just too poor to afford food. Today we'll be exploring some government-approved recipes to really make the most the people you know and love.
Sure.
In Meat's Back on the Menu, use the same basic structure as found in the SeaWorld, so you prepare as many recipes you can. But you have some special rules. There are no ingredients in the kitchen, however, there is still meat in the room. Characters can harvest three mystery meat ingredients from the corpse of a recently deceased humanoid.
Oh, that's good, that's good.
Ah, so, look, in the first scenario, if you can scroll
yes,
up,
there's...
Yeah, in the bin, there's one ingredient, in the fridge, there's four,
in the cupboard, there's three. Okay, okay, got it, got it.
Okay, in this scenario,
there's none.
There are no ingredients.
The winner is, again, the chef with the most stars.
Yep.
Then you got the Barracuda Bake Off. And now for our next challenge, the Great Barracuda Bake Off. Our chefs will be stretched to the limit as we fill the kitchen with water and unleash a giant barracuda on them. Will they be able to cook under pressure? Let's find out. So, same basic structure as in the SeaWorld, but with the special rules. The entire kitchen is underwater. Use the rule for underwater fighting in the PHB. In addition, at the start of round one, a huge barracuda, giant shark statistics, is led into the kitchen, which always targets a chef currently holding ingredients over other options. There's two in the fridge. No, three in the fridge, two in the cupboard, two in the bin. Again? Oh. Most stars or the chef who lands the killing blow on the barracuda with at least one meal prepared.
Nice.
That's a good special. Okay, and then the last one. Go ahead.
Hell's Kitchen. Don't turn away, folks. We've got some explosive content coming right up for you here on Master Shark. Our chefs will compete to create the spiciest menus of their culinary lives as we turn up the heat and see how quickly they boil over. Just some special rules. The kitchen begins to heat up each round. Check for heat exhaustion in PHB. At the end of each round. At the end of the fourth round, start rolling a D6. At the end of each round, on a 5 or 6, the scenario ends.
It's like the first one?
Oh, then it's 5 or 6.
So it's more.
Yeah, you have one ingredient in the cupboard, seven ingredients in the fridge, and zero ingredients in the bin.
Oh, wow, that's bad.
The winner of the round is the chef who has the most stars on their complete recipes.
All right, and now...
And now, let me check one thing.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
What's that? Each tile is 5 feet.
Yeah. Like an actual battle map.
Yeah, you have an actual battle map, and you can fight each other to get the access.
Yeah, they're fully fledged characters on this thing.
Yep.
So, you've got several types of, I think, three types of chefs this time.
Yeah.
First one is the frog chef, who is amphibious. It can do a standing leap of 20 feet and high jump up to 10 feet. Then it can, it has advantage on stealth checks made to hide in the kitchen. And it has some actions.
We can walk with the pan.
Then you have an extendable tongue, so you have reach on your grab, basically.
Yep.
That's cool. And then you have the swallow. Wow. Wow. All right.
One ingredient.
Or,
Let's read
so, one ingredient or finished meal. Target is swallowed and destroyed at the end of your next turn. Taking damage in the meantime causes you to regurgitate it.
Oh, so you can destroy you can steal, other you, cook's food.
Or you can steal their ingredients and barf them back up here.
Yep.
All right. Then
you get the seamen chefs, which they have limited amphibiousness, but they need to be submerged at least once for hours to avoid suffocating. You have blood frenzy. The swarm has advantage on melee attack rolls against any creature that doesn't have all its hit points.
Oh, wow, that's good.
And as an action, you get Mayhem with a kitchen knife.
Mame.
It's one target, plus you to hit, 1d4 plus 1 piercing damage. And the creature has the movement reduced by 5 feet. Cumulative.
Huh.
You have Augment Muscles. One per rest. You can cast Enlarge or Reduce on or Alter Self once this ability is requiring no components. And you have Runcible Spoon.
What the fuck?
It's plus 3 to hit, reach of 5. The target must succeed on a DC 13 Constitution saving throw or be blinded.
Wow.
You have Mustachio, Eyeballs, and Teeth. Each one has their respective name. Bigger on the face.
Okay. Then you've got Mad Fish Chefs, y'all. God. So, these guys are fully amphibious. They're slippery, with advantage on escaping grapple checks. Okay. Mad. They're mad as a feature. They're mad. The mad fish is mad. Do not come to them with your concerns about taste or smell.
Okay.
All right. You got the bite ankles as a melee attack. You got to improvise once per rest. You can throw away one of your recipes and choose another available recipe, or you can expend a spare ingredient. You have to...
You have in hand to regain 18.
Wow. So, wow.
You can heal yourself.
Wow, for 48.
Yep.
Nice. Then you've got bleach in your eyes, ranged weapon, acid damage, and the target is permanently blind. Then you've got sacrifice. As an action, the mad fish can gain one ingredient by harvesting a chunk of flesh from a living, willing humanoid. That creature loses one hit die permanently.
Okay. Wow.
So it can do that to itself, right? Oh, yeah, it can.
Yeah, it's one willing creature.
Okay. Then you've got recipes. So these are all DC 12 to 15. Yep. And let's see.
Look at the brown thing of DC 10.
Which is a cupcake?
It's a brown thing.
It's a brown thing.
You have something between bread. Sandwich.
You have it has icing on. Or something inside a pie case.
Okay, you have thing in a bowl.
For 2 stars, by the way, this time.
Yeah, you have flat thing, which is pizza.
It's pizza. Then you have heavy stuff on platter.
Jeez, 3 stars.
And it's a couple of things.
Yeah. It's things stacked on each other.
Which is pancakes.
Which is pancakes.
And then you've got thing in a bowl with garnish, which is heavy soup.
Yeah.
It's condiment soup. Okay.
Yeah.
Then
you have the curved thing, which is a croissant.
A bucket of stuff, which is pretty self-explanatory. Then you've got dead thing in a bowl, which is more horrible soup.
Yeah. You have skewer thing. Oh, okay. You have slice thing, which is bread.
Then you've got the emperor's new food.
Which is nothing, but requires 2 ingredients.
Wait. It's pretty good, though.
Yeah.
Then.
Stuff you pick up with sticks, which is sushi.
You've got slimy thing, which is impossible to eat, which is pasta.
Yeah, and the surprise menu.
Which is a box. All right. Then you've got...
ingredients.
So many ingredients. Oh, actually, not so many ingredients. So let's see here. You've got mystery meat, fish, egg, grapes.
Other are known as raw wine.
Carrots. Legends say these can cure blindness. In reality, they just taste a bit funny. Peanuts. Only a 3% chance of anaphylaxis.
You have cheese. Holy. Not divine.
Beetroot. Everything you own is now purple forever.
Yep.
Oh.
Yeah.
Spectra.
Yep.
Yeah, okay.
You have apple, organic, sourced from an evil crone with an agenda.
Then you've got bones. Better than nothing, supposedly.
Yeah. Spiky apple, which does not go on flat things.
Then you've got the aubergine. Wink.
Yeah. You get the cabbage, which is ew.
And it has a half skull reflected on it, if you
see. I guess.
You know? Then you've got unknown bottle juice. The only thing worse than unknown bottle juice would be knowing what's inside.
Yeah, the tiny green tree. Does it taste good? No. But you can make a very interesting forest dioramas from it. I always thought about that when eating broccoli. No. I did.
And you've got energy beans. Wait.
Am I leaving?
Good. Wow. Yeah, I know. I get it.
It's coffee.
I know. Then you've got pumpkin. Not a reliable substitute for public. Listen here, buddy.
Then you get seaweed, which is fancy, stringy, salty, and full of regret.
Then you get bad fish. A bad fish is 99 parts poison to 1 part delicious spleen. Prepare with care.
You get mushrooms. The risk of death is worth it.
Then you've got... curvy yellow herb. It's bendy. All food is more fun when it's bendy. Watch out for spiders. It's a banana.
You have the sad fish, as if your meal was already depressing enough.
Then you've got the dead fish.
Which is a skeleton of a fish.
Then you've got
gray meat.
And then lizard meat. Oh.
No descriptions.
Yeah, no descriptions. All right. You know, this one was shorter than the other one.
Yeah, it's made again by Oliver Clegg, and the artist
is again Kevin Miller. pretty fun.